am a possibility, I am a promise, with a capital P. I am a great big bundle of potentiality. And I am learning to hear God's voice, and I am trying to make the right choice. I am a promise to be anything God wants me to be. I can go anywhere that He wants me to go. I can be anything that He wants me to be. I can climb the high mountains. I can cross the wide sea. I am a great big promise, you see. I am a promise. I am a possibility. I am a promise with a capital P. I am a great big bundle of potentiality. Made the right choice. I am a promise to be anything God wants me to be. I am a promise to be anything God wants me to be.
Hello, hello, hello. Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the series of God of the Impossible with Pastor Shaun Brooks at the Portmore Sda Church. I am your host, Nadine Carr. Praise and worship will be done by the Graham Sisters. Opening prayer by Sister Sasha Gail Taylor. Presentation by Sister Renee Panton. And special feature by Colonel Morgan, pastor that is. And meditation song, Brother Lennox Duncan and Company. And then the man of the series, Pastor Shaun Brooks.
Call for songs of Good night, everyone. Let us pray. Dear Lord, thank you for your mercies throughout the day. Thank you for bringing us to another night of the Spirit-filled crusade. Thank you for putting in the minds of the Portmore brethren, for putting on this campaign for the members of the disability community. And thank you for allowing us, members of the disability community, to gain a blessing, and also for us to bring persons to your kingdom. Lord, also I want to thank you for this speaker, Pastor Brooks, for presenting your word night after night, and for allowing us, the members of the disability community, to gain a blessing and to bring souls for your kingdom, and help us that we will tell others about you and win souls for you, so that men and women, boys and girls, will be drawn closer to you, and will, and that we, the members of the disability community who are not given their lives to you, will do so before the eternally too late. Bless us, Lord, I pray. Amen.
Hello, everybody. Howdy do you do? We are glad to have you. Howdy do you, Jesus is here and bids you welcome. Howdy do you do? Hello, everyone. I am Desiree McFarlane, and tonight I am representing the Possibilities Ministry from the Portmore Seventh-day Adventist Church. On their behalf, I want to bring you greetings from near and far. And I also want you to know that we have other churches that are involved in the program that are supporting us. We are our special host, for example, Sister Carr is from the Brayton Seventh-day Adventist Church, and some of our singers are from churches all over. How wonderful it is to be a part of the family of God, that we can come together as different churches and celebrate and praise and worship and glorify God. Tonight, I have a very special task. I am going to ask everyone who is online to share this link with others. Welcome them too. I am going to call some names. Welcome, Sister Paulette Gooden. Welcome, Alicia McCoy. Please share this link. Eileen Francis, Pamela Robinson, Maisie Williams, Velveta Edwards, Shanique Chamberlain, Joan Millingen, and Pamela Robinson. Oh my goodness. It is so nice to have you. And I know that some of you belong to Pastor Shaun Brooks Church. And we thank you for partnering with us. Thank you for being here. Welcome. I see Sister Sylvina Williams just now. Welcome. And please remember, if you're on YouTube or you're on Facebook, remember to share the link with someone so that they can join with the Possibilities Ministry in winning souls for Christ. God bless you all. Until tomorrow evening. Hello, everybody. Howdy do you do? We are glad to have you. Howdy do you, Jesus is here and bids you welcome. Howdy do. See you tomorrow.
Good night, everyone. My name is Renee Pranton. My son Nathaniel was diagnosed with autism in March 2019. Now, autism, in short, is a disorder that affects the brain, in that these persons who have autism, they have social issues and they have problems communicating. Now, when Nathaniel goes to a party, it's very hard for him to make friends because his brain is not wired that way for him to just to be friendly. And so he would play by himself, which is one of the characteristics of autism. Communication skills, he doesn't speak spontaneously. So he will not say to me, "Mommy, I'm hungry. I need something to eat," or "Please, may I have something to eat?" He will just come and he will say, "Want juice," or "Please for juice." And so these are some of the problems that persons who have autism face on a daily basis. Sometimes these persons are looked upon, as especially children, as being rude when they have a meltdown. And a meltdown is because they're not able to express themselves and to say, "Okay, my head is hurting," or "My foot is hurting." And because of that, or they might not be able to say, "I want ice cream." And because they're not able to communicate that, they will have a meltdown or two, because they might hear some noise that doesn't affect normal neurotypical persons. And they might cover their ears at times. They might scream. They might even throw themselves on the ground. And of course, there are persons who are going to say, "Yeah, mother not train him good at home, and he come out a babe, so." But little persons will not know at times is that this child is trying to express him or herself, but the disorder is causing him or her not to do it. Now, Nathaniel being six, he goes to school. He comes home. I said, "Nathaniel, how was school?" "I get nothing." A normal neurotypical child would say, "Mommy, school was okay. We jumped over the tables. We had chicken for lunch." But I continued to talk with him as a normal neurotypical child. There are challenges with this type of sickness or disease. It's not a sickness really, it's actually not a disease either, it's a disorder, sorry. And some of the challenges, as I would have mentioned before, is not being able to socialize properly and not being able to communicate. Now, there are also sensory issues, be it food or even texture. For example, Nathaniel only eats basically plantain, be it ripe or green. So in the morning, it's not hard to look about his food, because we know in the morning he was going to eat eggs with ripe plantain, and in the evening he's going to eat green plantain with tuna fish or chicken. So it's not very hard. And of course, he loves KFC. So that's basically his meal. And so other neurotypical children will eat, in quotation, perhaps just about anything. That's another issue with autism. Now, being a mother and a teacher at times, it's one of the hardest things to teach my child, because I'm not trained to teach him. But as time progresses, God has been helping me to do little things with him. And not only that, God has been working on his speech, and he's helping him to do what he's supposed to be doing. And so I'm getting more words out of him now, especially the fact that he found yes and no. And so everything I tell him to do now, he tells me no. Whilst somebody will say he's being disobedient, yes, that could be the case, but I see it as a way of speaking more. Because if I say, "Nathaniel, please go on the bed," he will say no bed, or no, not going on the bed. And so I'm getting more words out of him. Now, when I look at autism, I question and I ask God, why? And I ask myself that 1,000 times, because it's one of the hardest things I have to deal with in life. And just recently, I said I'm going to look at it from a spiritual perspective to see what is my Romans 8 verse 28 in all of this. And while looking at it, I still haven't found it yet. I came up with an acronym for autism, which is adorable angels sent by God, who are unique individuals with awesome talents that are just indescribable. They are smart and they're a masterpiece for God. So I try to accept autism, which was not one of the easiest things. but it's a challenge. The more that we know about autism and the signs and symptoms about autism, we can help another person. But the best way that we can help somebody, a parent and a child with autism, is to pray for them. Prayer works, and it has been working for me. Through prayer, I can say that Nathaniel is learning how to communicate. He's learning to do so many, many things. And all things are possible with God. So when next you see somebody that has signs like autism, because remember, we are not trained to diagnose. And if you see somebody behaving strange, or if you hear a parent or somebody say, I have autism, remember that the person's ability to do something, it's better than their disability, or it's greater than their disability or inability to do something. Just remember this, that a person with autism, they're humans too. They need love and they need affection, just like you. Do not see the person's disability, but see their ability. Because autism is not just a disability, it's actually a different kind of ability. Thank you.
Thank you again. Thank you. Thank you for joining us. This is the best time, the best part of the service, because I am on and I am going to give gifts. Yes, I like to give away. I like to give good things. God has blessed us tremendously. He has given us life. He has given us health. He has given us strength. He has provided for our families. And I want you to know that because God has blessed us so much, we cannot keep God's blessing to ourselves. But I want to tell you more about this blessing, because I have good gifts for you. But to get the gifts, you have to answer my question. Now, tomorrow evening, I'll be sharing winners with you, and I'll also be sharing with you the answer to questions which I've asked in the week. But for tonight, I'll be sharing with you tonight two questions, and I want you to answer these two questions. So for tonight, we'll be taking persons from who are with disability, and we'll also be taking persons who do not have disabilities, and we will be giving you gifts. So two from persons with disability, that's not including the deaf. We'll have two persons who are deaf, and also we'll take two persons without disabilities. And so these questions are for you. Two questions. Are you ready for my riddle? Are you ready for my question? Here goes. Drum roll. Number one. Question number one. Did God answer Job's questions? Mm-hmm. That's question number one. Did God answer Job's questions? That's question number one. Question number two. What will we be doing during the 1,000 years in heaven? What will we be doing during the 1,000 years in heaven? So those are the two questions I have for you. And if you get the answers correctly, then you can walk away with my gifts. Now come tomorrow evening also, I'll be sharing with you the gifts. I'll be sharing with you what gifts you will receive if you can answer my question. And tonight also, there is a bonus. There is a bonus tonight. Now, if you can give me this one, then you are able to receive my gift. I'll take one person with disability who is not deaf, and I'll take one deaf, and I'll take one school without disability. Now, the question is very easy also. What is the name of a preacher? What is the name of the preacher? That's very easy. That's your bonus. And I'll tell you what you'll get for this one. You will receive credit for this one. You will receive the bonus one. You'll receive credit. That's for the bonus. Now, God gives you these gifts. He has blessed you. And because he has blessed you, you can't keep the blessing to yourself. So you must share that blessing with others. And so as you share how you will give back to God's cause, you give back through tithes, through offerings, through gifts and donations. And you perhaps may be wondering or perhaps been asking, how am I able to do that? How am I able to contribute? Well, you don't worry. I have the answer here for you. I've been asking you questions, and now you're asking the question. I am going to answer your question. This is how you can contribute. If you want to make donations to the for tithe offering, give donation or make gifts, then you call or text one of these numbers. And of course, you remember the Jamaican air code is 876. And the numbers are 321-8941. The next number is 379-0770. The next number is 860-5817. The next number is 898-2547. And the final number, 447-8032. Or you can do a bank deposit or do a transfer to the Portmore SD account, and it's a national commercial bank account, and it's Portmore branch. And the account number is 361-338-901. And the type of account is a business account, and the name of the account is Portmore SDA Church. Or you can also make contribution by going online at give.centraljA.org. That's give.centraljA.org. Yes, thank you very much for this wonderful time that you shared with me this evening. And as you continue to worship God, I trust and hope that your hearts will be elevated to a new height, to know that you are closer connected with Jesus. This evening, we have the one and only Pastor Kevin Barnaby, the senior pastor at the Portmore Seventh-day Adventist Church. Pastor Barnaby will come at this time and bring greetings and introduce our speaker. Pastor Barnaby.
Thank you so very much, Pastor Morgan, the senior pastor of the Deaf Church. May I say good evening, everyone. I trust that you have been having a wonderful time. I don't know about you, but I can tell you that since Sabbath, when we started with this very special series, my heart has been watered, and I'm sure that many persons across the length and breadth of Jamaica and even overseas would have been touched and enlightened by these powerful presentation. The joy is mine to introduce my very good friend. And I said my very, very good friend because we go way back from Northern Caribbean University. We have wonderful memories that we treasure to this day as brothers. And I'll just share this quick one with you. I think it was 1999. Dr. Brooks, you could correct me when you get the chance. Two young men were invited to conduct an evangelistic series in the East Jamaica Conference in the Olympic Way area. And Pastor Shaun and I were, that time we were students at NCU, And we took up the challenge. And at the end of that series, both of us, he did 2 weeks, I did 2 weeks, and we worked together in terms of sharing the word. And at the end of those 2 weeks, over 129 precious souls were baptized. And from that moment on, we've been very good friends. And I just want to publicly say, Dr. Brooks, I appreciate you, my friend. You are a godly man. You believe in family ministries. You believe in loving people. You demonstrate that in your life. And I just wanted to let you know personally how much my wife and I, how much we appreciate you. I just want to just share a little bit more about Dr. Brooks. Dr. Brooks is a graduate of Northern Caribbean University. He served in the East Jamaica Conference before migrating to the US of A. He did further studies at our Andrews University, where he did a master's and also a doctoral degree, where he did an emphasis in families who have persons suffering with disabilities. Presently, Pastor Brooks serves in the Georgia Cumberland Conference there in Atlanta, and he pastors the Atlanta All Nations Church family. Pastor Brooks is happily married to Stacey Ann, and the union would have produced 4 lovely children. It's a joy, Pastor Brooks, to have you sharing in the Central Jamaica Conference, and in a very special way, the Portmore Seventh-day Adventist Church. I want you to know without any doubt, sir, that your messages are coming directly from the throne of God. Many lives would have been transformed, and most of us, if not all of us, have been enlightened as to how to relate to individuals with disabilities. We appreciate you, Doc. You are a member now of the Portmore Seventh-day Adventist Church. You have the keys to our doors, and we will add your membership shortly. But just before you share the word with us, another special word, we will listen to a special song by Brother Lennox and company, Brother Robert. These two gentlemen will bless our hearts. The next voice you will hear will be that of Pastor Dr. Evangelist Shaun Brooks. Let us prepare our hearts to receive a word from God. Thank you.
To teach us right from wrong, we need an old-fashioned seeker who'd pray all night long. We need some good gospel singing to help us go another mile. I'm along. All right. Lift my name up to Jesus and help each other make it all. It will be worthy after all, child. It will be worthy after all. After all of these trials, you'll hear Jesus call.
Jesus call.
It will be worthy after all, child. It will be worthy after all. After all of this climbing, it will be worthy after all.
Down in the valley,
when you're down in the valley,
rain is all I can do.
Rain is all I can do.
All I can do.
The Lord send deliverance
and strengthen you.
And strengthen you.
Bring up on the mountain.
And when you walk on the mountain
and see me struggling.
And see me struggling.
Along.
Along, all right. Lift my name up to Jesus.
And help each other.
And help each other. Make it all.
Oh, yeah.
It will be worth it after all, child. It will be worth it after all. After all of this trial. Will be worth it after all, child. Will be worth it after all. After all of this trying, will be worth it after all. After all of this climbing, after all, after all, yeah.
Amen and amen. It will be worth it after all. After all of this climbing, it will be worth it after all. Thank you, Brother Lennox and Brother Roberts, for just enriching us with beautiful singing and praise. I just want to say thank you, Pastor Barnaby, for your kind words of introduction. This is one of my favorite preachers. I enjoy listening to him. He is a tremendous, tremendous leader, visionary, and motivator. And I do pray that, Portmore, you're enjoying him. As he said, we go back so far. We have worked together. We have sweat on the fields together. We have seen so much things together. And we've seen the power of God at work. At work. And so we would support each other. And I can just imagine when Jesus sent the disciples out two by two, we basically knew how that felt as we went into the community and witnessed for the Lord, the Holy Spirit poured down. And so, Pastor Barnaby, I know God is continually working in you. And I do pray that you'll continue to praise the Lord and to live for him. Please say hi to your wife for me. And indeed, we are praying for the entire family. Just want to say thank you to the prayer team. If you notice something about me, I try to call each person out. And I want to say thank you, Brother Myers. Thank you, Sister Wellington. Thank you, Sister Moncrief, Sister Williams, Sister Eileen, Sister Beckford, Pastor Morgan, and Sister Thompson for joining in the prayer room and lifting up this Possibilities Ministries and this revival. Thank you, Sister Carr. You know, she's the one that introduces a program night after night, and she comes with this beautiful smile and so radiant,
and you feel at home. So Sister Kerr, you are allowing us to enjoy the program. So thank you, Sister Kerr. Thank you. Sister Taylor, thank you for the prayer. Sister Desiree, you came with a beautiful song there, just allowing us to feel good and loved. And you told us and encouraged us to share this message. So I'm encouraging everyone to share the program as well. And then Sister Panton shared a presentation on autism. And thank you for your openness. I just want to say that for my doctoral program, I studied how the church can minister to those with autism spectrum disorder and other special needs. So it is a topic that is dear to my heart. And I thank you for the information that you shared. Powerful. Pastor Morgan, night after night, you have been there on this program, encouraging, engaging the congregation. And I appreciate your faithfulness. I appreciate just your enthusiasm in all that you do. And so I also want to welcome all who are listening all across the world, the members and visitors from Portmore, and also the Atlanta All Nations Church family. I know some of you are out there listening. Thank you for your support through the week. I see you. and so I just want to say thank you for your support. Thank you for praying for me, for encouraging me, and for just being there throughout this period of my ministry. I appreciate you. You have been a strong tower of support in my ministry. Well, saints of God, I would like to just pray that God will speak to us this evening. The topic for tonight is overcoming the giant of depression. Overcoming the giant of depression. And I know it's a sensitive topic. I know it's one that many individuals may be aware of, may have gone through or continually struggle with. So please pray for me that God will use me and speak through me clearly. And at the end of the day, we can find hope in Christ Jesus. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for your blessings. We thank you for your mercies. And as we open your word to look at this relevant and powerful topic, Lord, we pray that you will speak to us, speak to our hearts, renew a right spirit within us. And help us, Lord, to draw closer to you and to be a church family that makes room for those with disabilities. Thank you, Lord, for blessing us. In Christ's name, amen. According to the CDC, the Center of Disease Control, depression is a serious medical illness and an important public health issue. Depression is characterized by persistent sadness and sometimes irritability, and is one of the leading causes of disease or injury worldwide for both men and women. According to Dr. Carla Thompson, in the article Depression and Disability, it is an illness that affects more than 17 million Americans each year. Many of those people are individuals with disabilities. And she goes on to say, not everyone with a disability becomes depressed. And those who do become depressed may not be depressed because of their disability. However, people with disabilities face unique challenges and stresses which place them at an increased risk for depression. So what are some of the challenges? What are some of the challenges? There is a challenge of mobility problems, sometimes needing help to get to a certain destination, and it can be frustrating to ask or to wait for someone. There's a problem of accessibility. Most homes and many businesses are not up to code for ensuring accessibility for wheelchairs, scooters, walkers, and canes. We have the challenges that social barriers and social isolation brings about, where there are individuals with negative attitudes towards those with disabilities. They don't know how to relate to others. Employment. It is difficult to find and to keep a job. And oftentimes there are misconceptions that are out there about those with disabilities or special needs or being differently able. And so the employers refuse or choose not to hire them. And once, you know, there's no finance coming in, that also can lead to depression. Health. Some disabilities incur more costs than others, so you can imagine the strain. Then there's the problem of lack of empathy, where some individuals look and move just like non-disabled people, but have trouble hearing, speaking, seeing, reading, thinking, paying attention, or remembering, because these are invisible, hidden, and non-visible disabilities. So people are saying, what's wrong with you? Not recognizing easily that this individual may have a disability. Saints of God, some of the causes of depression may be of a biological nature, heredity, personality, and or life experiences. Depressive disorders involve chemical changes in the brain. And people with depression typically have too much or too little of certain brain chemicals called neurotransmitters. Thankfully, there are many effective treatments for depression. Many effective treatments that are out there. But sadly, some are unable to make use of them for lack of access, while others completely refuse to seek treatment. The giant called depression, friends, does not care what job you have, does not care about your career, education, wealth, or knowledge. I call depression a giant because once it latches onto you, it continues to grow unless helped, unless you fix the problem or at least counter it. By God's grace, you will be able to recognize some of the key signs of depression and seek ways to limit the growth of this giant. Turn your Bibles with me to 1 Kings chapter 19. And here we're going to read about an encounter that a mighty, mighty prophet of God encountered. Now, I told you that depression can hit anyone, even a mighty warrior, a mighty preacher as Elijah. Elijah had just defeated the prophets of Baal. And God was vindicated in front of all Israel because God himself sent fire down from heaven and lit the altar that Elijah had built. And so for further context, you can read chapters 17 and 18 in 1 Kings. King Ahab, who was at first against Elijah, now acted like a baptismal candidate. Come on now. You see, King Ahab had hated Elijah before. But now, after chapter 18, we find that King Ahab was like a baptismal candidate. He was penitent. He was ready to go into the pool. He was ready to turn his life around. And so, in order to reverse the drought that was on the land, that was there for 3.5 years, Elijah prayed 7 times for rain, and it came. It poured. He ran before the chariot of Ahab to bring him to his home. Saints of God, Elijah was on a high, a mountaintop experience. And you would think the story would end there with the refrain, Elijah lived happily ever after. But that was not the case. In Elijah's mind, every single Israelite would now readily worship the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. But Elijah was in for a great disappointment. He was in for a rude awakening. So I read from verse 1. The Bible says, and Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done, and withal how he had slain all the prophets with the sword. Then Jezebel sent a messenger unto Elijah, saying, so let the gods do to me, and more also, if I make not thy life as the one, as the life of one of them by tomorrow about this time. And when he saw that, he arose and went for his life and came to Beersheba, which belongeth to Judah, and left his servant there. At this point in the story, Elijah meets the one person as committed to Baal as he is to Yahweh. What Jezebel hears from Ahab causes her to threaten Elijah's life, and she swears by the gods that Elijah will die. Jezebel has killed Yahweh's prophets before in 1 Kings 18 and verse 4 and verse 13, as you can see. So Elijah has no reason to doubt her threats, for they indicate her true intentions. One commentator says, this woman has the fierceness Ahab lacks, the civil authority the prophets of Baal lacked, and a freshness for battle that Elijah no longer possesses. She is as worthy an opponent as God's servants ever face in Scripture. Who or what can defeat her? Elijah, upon hearing the news that his life was at risk, without a moment's hesitation, picks himself up and takes off running. He received no command from God, no orders to do so, but he takes off with fear and terror driving him. And anxious to preserve his life, he flees and travels 80 to 100 miles from Jezreel to Beersheba. It would take you 5 to 10 days by foot to get there. And in those days of fleeing, of running, the giant of depression took a hold on Elijah and started to grow in his life. If you read verse 3, the Bible says, and when he saw that he arose and went for his life and came to Beersheba, which belongeth to Judah, and left his servant there, he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat down under a juniper tree. And he requested for himself that he might die, and said, it is enough. It is enough now, O Lord, take away my life, for I am not better than my fathers. Here are some key signs of depression. For one, you may experience mood change, where you're feeling sad, lost, hopeless, and empty. Elijah was on a high. Now he was at a low. There's also the loss of interest or pleasure in usual activities. Elijah enjoyed going in the wilderness and going on God's errands. No more! Elijah probably experienced a change in appetite. He did not feel like eating. He was feeling low. He now suffered from fatigue. He was tired. There's also the feelings of worthlessness and self-reproach that may come your way. And the problem is this guilt and self-reproach is way out of proportion because you feel condemned and abandoned by God. Then there's a change in thinking and concentration. You see, at this point, Elijah was not thinking clearly. There was no reason for him to run. God had just brought fire down from heaven. Why was he running? He was not thinking clearly. And suicidal thoughts or acts may come when a person is severely depressed as well. The individual may frequently think about death and wish to be dead. Elijah had reached that point. I want to die, God. As he thought to himself, Elijah saw apparent failure. You see, he truly expected Israel to be converted. He expected them to run to the Lord. He expected both rich and poor, king and pauper, to submit their lives to God. Elijah had high expectations. And this is a trigger point for many individuals. High expectations. High expectations can be a formula for painful disappointments. Be wary of the expectations that you set. Understand that people may not live up to it. The king was ready for baptism. Hear me now. The king was ready for baptism. And Elijah was happy about the thought that he was about to baptize the entire royal family. But the queen stood in the way. And because both did not accept the message, it was enough to throw him off. He had high expectations that the royal family would be converted. But Elijah did not take into account that people may disappoint you. Saints of God, some of us are in the search for the perfect church here on earth. But get ready for some disappointments. You're looking for the perfect pastor. And I know Pastor Morgan and Pastor Barnaby comes close, but guess what? No one is perfect. You're looking for the perfect elders, the perfect board members, the perfect individuals in churches. But my brothers and sisters, a reminder, this church is a hospital full of sinners who are on the road to recovery. And if you believe you have perfect parents, you may be disappointed when you see and become aware of their faults and mistakes. And there are parents today who are depressed because they realize their children are not perfect. Be mindful of setting high, unrealistic expectations and then crashing when these expectations are not met. Later we find that Satan attacked him in his area of strength. Hear me out again. Satan attacked Elijah in his area of strength. Elijah was known as the bold prophet. And he himself thought maybe that this was something I'm known for. This is what I'm good at. I'm a bold prophet. I don't care about any king. I will stand before the king. I will face 850 prophets of Baal because I'm bold and I'm courageous for God. But Satan looked and said, all right, you're brave. You're courageous. I'm going to attack you on your strength. And when Elijah, in that moment, began to run, he was now thinking to himself, my whole self-image was built upon my courage. I'm not brave anymore. Therefore, I'm no good. God, get rid of me. Some people have built their self-image upon their good looks. But saints of God, as time progresses, you will not look the same as you did when you were 15. Some build it upon their wealth. So Satan attacks and drains your account, and all of a sudden, your world is upside down. And the list can go on. There are some who builds it upon their faithfulness in church. Everybody knows them as a faithful deacon, the faithful deaconess, the faithful pastor. But then when people realize they have made mistakes or were unfaithful in certain areas of their life, their world crumbles before them. Elijah suffered from lack of appreciation as well. That's a trigger point. Where we will say to ourselves, I'm doing all this work. Nobody appreciates me. Nobody is showing me gratitude. And that can mess up your thinking. Elijah also did something. As the Bible indicates, as he journeyed on, running from Jezebel, he left his servant behind him. His servant may have been like a disciple. He's teaching this young man. He left him behind and continued by himself. You see, Elijah, he may have felt all alone, but look what he did. He left this person. He didn't want to be near that individual. When we are depressed, we don't want to stay with anyone. We remove ourselves from church. We remove ourselves from the society of those who know us best. And then we say, no one likes me. No one wants to be around me. But I'm here to share with you that God cares. There is someone who has never left your side. And who loves you with an everlasting love. I'm here to share with you that God cares. He cares for you in those moments when things are going right. And he also cares for you when the world seems out of control and you're hitting rock bottom. He cares for you when you are the recipient of applauses from the crowd, as well as those times when you are the recipient of ridicule from the same crowd. He cares for you when your friends are many, and he cares for you when your friends are few and far between. God knows all too well the struggles that we face with depression. And scripture gives us an insight as to some of God's solutions in this chapter. So let's look at God's solutions for depression, especially in light of his servant Elijah. For one, we find that God allowed him to talk, to hear out how he feels. Remember, yesterday we shared that God allowed Job to speak his mind. And God was upset that Job's friends interrupted him. So God said, all right, Elijah, speak. Let me hear your complaints. So in verse 4, he said, Lord, take away my life, for I am not better than my fathers. Verse 10. And he said, I have been very jealous for the Lord God of hosts, for the children of Israel have forsaken thy covenant. And he's now saying, and slain the prophets, and I only am left, and they seek my life. God says, continue, let me hear you. And verse 14, he said, I have been very jealous for the Lord God of hosts, because the children of Israel have forsaken thy covenant, thrown down thine altars, and slain thy prophets. God is allowing him to speak and to hear out how he feels. You see, the feelings and experiences of Elijah were very real to him. Likewise, the feelings and experiences of someone going through depression are very real to them. Listen to what they are saying. Give them the opportunity to share. Next, God allowed him to rest. Verse 5, the Bible says, he lay and slept under a juniper tree. Now, I'm not necessarily following the chronological order there, but he allowed him to sleep. Sometimes we are tired. Sometimes, really, we have pushed ourselves to the edge, and we're depleted, and we're tired, and our batteries need to recharge. It is said that humans can only go 11 days without sleep, after which your body begins to shut down and then you die. Maybe this is why, if you don't mind me tying in, this is why God says in Exodus 20 and verse 8, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shall you labor, shall you do all your work. It's good to work. It's good to be busy. But God says on the seventh day, on this seventh day, you must rest, cease, stop your labor. This is a day that I ceased my labor in creation and halted. I did not need the rest, but I am giving you the time to regenerate yourself. Now I have a phone here, and I've learned very recently, I'm slow with tech and devices, that you have wireless chargers. You just place them, the phone on it, and it begins to charge. You see, the Sabbath is like a wireless charger. You can't look at the day and say, look, there's a blessing on the day. You can't see the connection. You can't see the connection of the blessing on the day. But God says, I have built the Sabbath and it will be my charger. It will charge you. It will rejuvenate you. When you rest on the Sabbath by faith, I will charge your body. I will charge up your mind. I will give you peace. I will give you strength. And so we keep the Sabbath by faith. We can't see the connection, but by faith we believe that we are being rejuvenated by the power of God. Next, God fed him. Verses 5 and 6. Gotta read it. Have to read it. The Bible says, as he lay and slept under a juniper tree, behold, then an angel touched him and said unto him, arise and eat. And he looked, and behold, there was a cake baking on the coals and a cruse of water. That's the best fluid, the best juice, natural juice, water. That's the best thing you can drink. And he did eat and drink and laid him down again. Sometimes when we are feeling depressed and we don't want to eat, thank God for the gentle angels in our lives who touches us and say to us, come and eat. Brothers and sisters, you can go about 8 to 21 days without food before your body starts to shut down. And God was working on his physical conditions, his physical needs first. Then in verse 8, we find that God brought him to a quiet place. The Bible says, so he got up and ate and drank. Strengthened by that food, he traveled 40 days and 40 nights until he reached Horeb, the mountain of God. Please, friends, don't try this at home. It was God who gave him this food, and God strengthened him by this food. It was like heavenly manna for him. God strengthened him, and he was able to move for 40 days and 40 nights for that journey. a 200-mile journey. And then while there, please follow me now, God then asked him a probing question. He asked him in verse 9, "What doest thou here, Elijah? What doest thou here?" Now God began with the usage of a question. It has now been seen by counselors and philosophers that questions are the keys to unlocking the potentials of individuals and helping them to get out of the fog of depression or a judgmental and closed perspective. If you're in a dead end for answers, you can open the roadways by asking the right questions. So God says, "What doest thou here?" He asks the question, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" God knew the answer, but he was trying to draw it out of him. So God asked the question and sat and listened to him. The question was filled with hope. For in it, God was saying, "I am not done with you, Elijah. I am just getting started with you. What doest thou here?" Elijah was saying, "I'm no good." But God was saying, "I am starting with you. You are blessed, but I'm going to build you up and build your confidence." You see, God declares in Isaiah 1 and verse 18, he says, "Come now, let us reason together." We're talking about a God that enjoys talking. He enjoys listening to us. He says, "Come, let us reason together. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they be red as crimson, they shall be as wool. Come and let us reason." You see, God is a mighty counselor. A mighty counselor. The greatest counselor the universe has ever known. And the principles, hear me now, the principles that God uses are oftentimes what is used by modern counselors today. So my brothers and sisters, hear me, stop running from counseling. Stop running from counseling. When I studied at Western East College, then now Northern Caribbean University, we had those who studied under the degree of counseling, and they would study and learn how to ask questions. They would learn how to encourage individuals to really draw from within and come up with solutions. There are students all over the world who are graduating right now, and they have studied in this area, studied in this field, and they're good at it. Don't run away from them. They are actually practicing what God was laying out as a plan. You need to probe and ask questions and bring it out. Allow them to bring it out. So don't give up, saints, on behavioral therapy. Don't give up on counseling and counselors. They're actually borrowing from God, and they're helping you to overcome the giant of depression. It's not the time to say, "I'm a man and I don't need any help," or I don't want anybody in my business. That's not the time. You may need to change. And it has been said that when the pain of staying the same is greater than the pain of change, you will change. Don't wait until it becomes overwhelming and painful before you seek help. Help is available. God showed him how to observe life's little things. Life's little things. In verse 11, God on that mountaintop sent a great strong wind that shook the mountain. But Elijah recognized that God was not in the mountain, in the wind, sorry. Then God sent an earthquake And yet God was not in the earthquake. And he allowed a fire to start, but God was not in the fire. And then there was a still small voice. And it was so when Elijah heard it that he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood, because he knew this was the voice of God. What was God trying to teach him? God was saying, listen, I am not in necessarily the big things. Elijah, you were hoping to convert the entire camp of Jerusalem. You're hoping to convert the entire royal family. Not even I had such great expectations. Your expectations exceeded even mine. Elijah, you forgot to celebrate the people around the altar who gave their hearts to me. Elijah, you forgot to give God the glory for King Ahab, who was this close in going into the water. He was a candidate, if I may say, for baptism, but you were not celebrating him. You were waiting for everybody to be converted. Before you celebrate, you need to see the small things in life and appreciate the small things in life. So you may say, I cannot preach like the pastor. I cannot do certain things because I may have some disabilities. But God says this, listen, the smile you gave to that sister when she was feeling down, you were actually smiling at me. The help you gave to those children to go back to school, you actually were blessing me. For what you have done to the least of these, my brethren, you have done it to me. I am a God who takes note of the small things. I take note of the details. So, God did something else. God got him active again. Did you hear me? God got him active once more. In verse 15, God said to him, go anoint Hazael to be king over Syria. And verse 16, and anoint Jehu to be king over Israel. And Elisha, I have called somebody else. Elisha, I want you to go and train him to be a prophet in thy place. Now, hear me out, saints. God got him busy again. God could have done all those things by himself. But God employed Elijah and made him basically a co-laborer with him to anoint these individuals. God could have done it by himself. But he said, I'm going to work with Elijah. Church family, church leaders, please hear me. Please, please look out for those in the Possibilities Ministries community and get them involved. Yes, you may be able to do it, but please let them be co-laborers in the church. Get them involved. Thank God for the opportunity we have because of COVID, where people are at home and they can participate. Well, guess what? They can also participate in the leadership decisions. They can participate in the programs of the church. They can participate in the singing of the church. Get them involved. Use God's example here. And for the business leaders out there, look out for those in the Possibilities Ministries community. Hire them. Stop this stigma or stigmatization. Stop looking down upon them and putting hurdles in their way that they cannot get the job. Some jobs require that you must lift 25 pounds. Yet if you ask some of those laborers who have been working there all their lives, they never lift 25 pounds before. But you have excluded all those with a disability who may not be able to lift 25 pounds. Let's look at some of those laws. Let's look at the way we have separated them and prevented them from engaging in the church and engaging in the community. God said, I will get you involved, Elijah. Finally, God revealed to him that you're not alone, Elijah. You're not alone in this situation. In verse 18, God said to him, I have left me 7,000 in Israel, all the knees which have not bowed unto Baal, and every mouth which has not kissed him. So Elijah, as faithful as you are, there are others who are just as faithful. They are just as diligent. They are just as brave and courageous. I am aware of them. I know their struggles. It's just that I did not place that burden upon you. I am carrying the burden of those 7,000. But I also am carrying your burden. I'm carrying you by the shoulder as well. But understand, you are not alone. Others are going through the same thing. Maybe Elijah got off his knees and began to sing the praises to God. You see, in times of sorrow, we can still say, my soul doth trust in him. In times of joy, we can say, my soul will extol him on high. Now hear me, saints. Elijah had come to a very dark place where he said, let me die, God. I want to die. And God says, no, I'm going to give you some rest. God, let me die. No, I'm going to feed you. God, let me die. No, I'm going to encourage you. God, let me die. No, I will not make you taste death. Instead, I'm sending my chariot for you. You're going to come up to heaven. You will not taste death on earth. You wanted to die. I want you to live. My brothers and sisters, the books of Matthew chapter 17, Mark chapter 9, and Luke chapter 9 tells the story in Jesus' final days on earth, where he was contemplating the scenes that would play out when he would go to Jerusalem. And Jesus may have become a little anxious about what was about to play, what was about to take place. His divinity was shrinking back when he thought about the sins of the world being placed upon his head. His humanity was shrinking back when he thought about the lacerations on his back, which he brought about by the whips. He thought about the nails going into his hands and his feet. And Jesus was maybe at this point sinking a bit in depression. And he climbed up a mountain with Peter, James, and John. And while praying to the Father looked at the Son and said, I need to send somebody down there to encourage my Son. God looked and said, Moses, come here for a minute, Moses. Come here for a moment. I need you, Moses, to go down there and encourage my Son. Because Moses, I know you know how it feels to be rejected. Moses, you know what it feels to be downtrodden and depressed. Moses, your self-confidence was so hurt that it affected your speech. Moses, in the midst of your depression, you named your son Gershom, which means stranger in a strange land. You were severely depressed, Moses. And because you know about depression, go and encourage my son. And the father looked again and said, Elijah, come here. I need you. Elijah, you know what it means to be afraid. You know what it means to have fear crippling you. You know what it means to be betrayed because King Ahab and Jezebel turned on you. You know, Elijah, what it means to suffer failure, to do all of that, and yet still the people turn their backs. You know how it feels. And Elijah, I want you to go to Jesus because you have been in the valley of depression. You have been in the pit of darkness. You know how it feels. Go and encourage my son. So the next thing we see is that both Moses and Elijah are standing there beside Jesus, and Luke says that they gave him a word, and the word was not one that said in this life there are no problems. The word was not a prosperity gospel message that riches will come your way. The word was one that said, Jesus, you have a hard road to travel. Jesus, you have to bear the cross. Jesus, you cannot avoid it, but you can go through it. Jesus, don't give up. They had a message for him. Now, listen to me, saints. Jesus surrounded himself with two individuals who struggled with depression in times past. He surrounded himself with people who knew what it meant to go in the valley, who knew what it meant to suffer defeat, who knew what it meant to have emotional and psychological pain. He wanted these two men to help to encourage him. And as Jesus looked at Moses and Elijah, some thoughts went into his head because he saw Moses, and Moses represents those who will die and those whom he must save. Moses represents those who have died with a broken heart because Moses did not get to go into the promised land. Moses suffered from depression from that mistake. Moses suffered from depression from the initial rejection of the Israelites. And God said, for people who suffer from depression in this life and die, I must die for them. Then Jesus looked at Elijah and said, there are people like Elijah who are going through depression, and it is extremely challenging for them. It comes and grows in their life day after day. But for people like Elijah, who will still be alive when I come back on this earth, I must go to the cross for them. My brothers and my sisters, I'm just here to encourage you in Jesus. You may be going through depression right now as I speak, but when, like Elijah, when, like Moses, when, like Job, you can hold on to God in the midst of your depression, in the midst of your valley, you are actually encouraging Jesus right now. Because right now in heaven, Jesus is interceding on our behalf, but the world still ignores Jesus. How do you think he feels working so hard for humanity, and humanity is still rejecting him. But you can encourage him today by faith and by trusting in him and by giving your life to him. You can make his labor sweet while he's there in heaven. For his mind, his heart is upon you. He loves you with an everlasting love. And he longs, Jesus says, I long to drink of this vine with you in paradise. I long to take you to heaven. I've made a place for you, and I will come to receive you unto myself. Hold on. If you're depressed, I encourage you, get the help. But as you're getting the help from those in society who can help you, I would encourage you to hold on to Jesus. He is holding on to you. If tonight you just want to say, Jesus, I will hold on, you can type in the chat, I will hold on. I am struggling, preacher. I have financial struggles, but I will hold on. Preacher, I am not able to move around as I would like to because of my disability, but I will hold on. Preacher, I found from the doctor that I have Alzheimer's, but preacher, even though my thoughts will be affected, I know that God still loves me. I will hold on. Tonight, I encourage you to hold on. Jesus will never, ever let you go. And if you want to be a part of those who will be baptized this Sabbath, the day of rest, the day of rejuvenation, then I invite you to come and worship with the Portmore Saints or join us online. But if you want to be baptized, you have to give your number. You have to call this number. You have to say that in the chat, that the workers can reach you, that they can pray for you. Because we want to celebrate with you. You see the numbers right before you. We want to pray for you. We want to pray with you. We want you to have peace of mind. No matter what you're going through, hold on. No matter your challenges, hold on. Let us pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for the privilege and the opportunity of coming to you. Lord, I am encouraged by the fact that the weakest sinner on his or her knees will cause you to empty heaven of all its angels to help that individual. So God, it matters not the challenges that we face. It matters not the disabilities that we face, because you can bring about possibilities in all that we do. So God, we're praying that you will heal tonight the brokenhearted. I pray that something that has been said will encourage individuals to get help out there, but also help from above. So God, we thank you for hearing and answering prayers. We thank you for sweet deliverance. We thank you for those who are saying, I want to be baptized. I want Bible study. I want prayer. I want to know Jesus more. We thank you for those decisions. And Lord, I just want to personally say thank you for loving us, even in those dark times when we felt that you were not there, even when we felt like giving up and we were saying to just kill us, get rid of us. Thank you for breathing life into us. Thank you for sending friends to encourage us. Thank you for sending your angels from above to strengthen. Thank you for your Holy Spirit that dwells in us. And oh God, we thank you for one day coming for us. We praise your name and we thank you in the mighty name of Jesus. May God continue to bless and keep you. We'll be back tomorrow night. So please bring a friend. And if you enjoyed this message, share it on your timeline. Let someone else receive a blessing and a word of encouragement. May God continue to bless and keep you, saints of God. Take care.
Good night, one more time again. Pastor has done it again, and I'm so pleased. He's talking to me. I don't know about you guys, but he is talking to me, and I will hold on. And I'm asking you out there to hold on as well. Being a disabled, yes or no, we all need to hold on. So my brothers and my sisters, we will come back again tomorrow night for a better and a more important message. So good night.
I am a promise. I am a possibility. I am a promise. With a capital P, I am a great big bundle of potentiality. And I am learning to hear God's voice, and I am trying to make the right choice. I am a promise to be anything God wants me to be.
I can go anywhere that He wants me to go. I can be anything that He wants me to be. I can climb the high mountains. I can cross the wide sea. I am a great big promise, you see.
I am a promise. I am a possibility. I am a promise with a capital P. I am a great big bundle of potentiality. And I am trying to make the right choice. I am a promise to be anything God wants me to be. I am a promise to be anything God wants me to be.